squeeze that.
Yeah.
Good morning, good morning. I see that there are still a few people getting coffee. I want to make sure everybody has their coffee. This goes until noon, so make sure you have your caffeine. Thank you so much for gathering for our annual State of the University address. So much has been accomplished in the last 2 years, and this is a good time for us to pause, to reflect on what we've achieved, and to take a look at where we're headed into the future. I'd like to acknowledge one of our trustees who is in the room. Aaron Black was just nominated as the chair of the Board of Trustees. Aaron is here, thank you. And I'd like to acknowledge Sasha Wolpart, who is also here. She was getting coffee, there she is, excellent. Sasha provides an amazing amount of support to me, but she's also deeply committed to the Wildcat community and the local community. She serves on the Kittitas Environmental Education Network Board, but she also is part of the Wildcat Coalition and has joined the suicide prevention team in the efforts that we have to advance mental health here on our campus. So thank you, Sasha, for that work. I also want to make sure that I give a shout out to our ASCWU team who is here, and I see that several of them are here. Malik, Yari, and Nick are here, and Melissa, Michelle, anybody else from your team? That's it, great. Thank you for the work you do. We are all here for students. This is why we're here, and it is so awesome to have such a fantastic leadership team in ASCWU who will work with us to make sure that we are always focused on student engagement and success. So thank you for your leadership and your work. And I'd also like to give a shout out to our ASCWU president from last year, Luis, who is here and is running our Jumpstart program. Before we begin, I'd like to acknowledge the land that we reside on is the historic home of the Yakima people. The federally recognized confederated tribes and bands of the Yakima Nation remain committed stewards of the land, cherishing it and protecting it as instructed by the elders through the generations. We are honored and grateful to be here today on their traditional lands. We give thanks to the legacy of the original people, their lives, and their descendants. I read this statement as a reminder that the land is not owned. It is rather a gift that is inherited. In taking responsibility for that gift, we must think of the seven generations, of how we will pass this gift forward and create a legacy worthy of our inheritance. I also want to honor the survivors of the boarding schools and note that tomorrow, September 30th, is National Day for Truth and Reconciliation. It's also known as Orange Shirt Day, as inspired by Phyllis Jack Webstadt's experience of having the orange shirt that her grandmother gave her taken away from her when she went to the residence school. You will notice that lots of people in this room are wearing orange today. Thank you all so much for what you're doing and for your activism. We need to remember this work and take this work seriously. So thank you all for wearing your orange. Let's remember this work. All right, spoiler alert. How many of you are watching The Bear or have seen The Bear? Okay, several of you. If you haven't, it's a fantastic show. I'm gonna talk about a scene from episode 7 in season 2. During this episode, Richie, who is the main character's, is a close family friend, but they call him cousin. He's been floundering. He's not had purpose or meaning or direction. And Carmine Borsato, the main character, Carmi, sends Richie off to a really high-end restaurant where he is assigned for an entire week to do nothing but polish forks. And in the beginning of the scene, when he's polishing these forks, he just tossed them in the pile. He's like, what a waste of time. What in the world am I doing? But as the week goes on, and as he gets to experience the service that is provided to the customers, where every small detail matters, where every customer is treated as something, someone special and unique. He takes a turn during that episode. He comes to understand that even polishing forks has meaning and purpose, that every small detail is part of some bigger experience that provides richness to the lives of the customers. He comes to understand that he plays an important part in a larger ecosystem of deep care. The same is true for each and every one of you. It doesn't matter what your role is, what tasks you complete during the week. The point is that what all of you do together adds up to something profound: the transformation of the lives of our students, their families, and their communities. As a result of your work, great things happen here at Central Washington University, and I want to start with sharing two stories. Last year, Central Washington University won the Undergraduate Award for the Intentional Endowments Network Challenge. The challenge is a semester-long program that includes education, mentorship, and hands-on investment strategy development for undergraduate and graduate students. The shareholder engagement strategy that the students have to produce during this competition is focused on addressing inequality and the climate crisis, systemic risks that threaten a healthy society, and in turn, a healthy portfolio return. Other schools who competed in this: Northeastern, UCLA, Berkeley, Columbia, Lehigh, the University of Chicago, and our undergraduate students won. That's because of what you all do with them inside and outside the classroom. Anderson Parks received the 2023 American Council for Education Reginal Wilson Diversity Leadership Award. Andy is the Milton Qualt Professor of Business and a DEI faculty fellow who teaches in the Department of Management. He's located over in the Linwood campus. This is a tremendous honor for Central Washington University and for Andy in that it recognizes his contributions both on and off campus, including his leadership with the Washington Employers for Racial Equity. Andy received this award last April at the annual ACE meeting in Washington, D.C. Please join me in honoring Andy for his leadership. When I did this presentation at the executive leadership team, they were like, Jim, what are your three takeaways? What are your three takeaways? And I thought I'd put them in a slide. This is what I want you to know as a result of this conversation today. First, I want you to know that what you do matters. Like Richie polishing forks, every single person here makes a difference in the work that we do together. Thank you for your dedication, your passion, your commitment to our students, to their lives, their growth. Second, after 2 years of collaborative and inclusive work, we are becoming a vision, mission, values aligned university. And I will use the new vision, mission, values, and strategic plan to frame the conversation today. You'll see that we are already well on our way to tackling many of the initiatives that we wrote into our strategic plan. Third, I will let you know what you already know. We've overcome some headwinds. We have more headwinds to face, and I will share that with you quite candidly. But we have a bright future ahead of us because of the team that we are building, the community we are building, and our passion, our dedication, and our commitment. Simon Sinek reminds us that we should always start with understanding our purpose. Why are we here? If we can remind ourselves daily of our purpose in all that we do, we will find that our work will be meaningful and worthwhile. I believe we've answered that question in our vision, our mission, and our unifying value. Our vision statement boldly proclaims that we will be a model learning community of equity and belonging. And I want to pull out two critical phrases in this statement. To be a model learning community means that we will need to question the status quo, to be curious and inquisitive, to focus not on showing up based on how much we know and how much we've done in the past, but rather being open to what we can learn from each other and from others outside of Central. And we will do that work with a focus on equity and belonging, which I believe we have defined very carefully in our values and our strategic plan. We do need to remember that this vision statement is aspirational. It is not who we are today. It is who we hope to become. Our mission statement flows out of the vision and announces that we will nurture culturally sustaining practices that expand access and success to all students. These are powerful concepts. It will not be sufficient to be culturally responsive, to respond to and acknowledge other cultures. What we agreed to in this mission statement is that we will lift up, we will elevate, we will sustain the diverse languages, literacies, histories, cultures that our faculty, staff, and students bring to this campus community. And we will focus our efforts on expanding access to a high-quality university education to more students, to students who have been historically excluded, and we will ensure their success. And finally, when we think about why we are here, we can refer to our unifying value of student success. We are here to create pathways for students of all backgrounds to reach their academic and professional goals. These statements of our purpose, of why we're here, feel very natural, I think. That doesn't mean that we're fully living into them or that they're easy. I could draw on a lot of stories to talk about the way in which some of those aspects are being lived in our current experience. So I want to talk about two real quick. The National Science Foundation's Graduate Research Fellowship Program is a highly exclusive opportunity for students to pursue a graduate degree in the sciences, providing 3 years of financial support to attend graduate school, including a $37,000 annual stipend for living expenses. Central Washington University senior and McNair scholar, senior last year, and McNair scholar Nicholas Puentes became one of only four Wildcats to ever receive this award. Puentes developed his research skills in part through his work with Associate Professor of Physics Benjamin White. I don't know if Benjamin White is in the room, maybe not, who served as one of his faculty members. It'd be great if Benjamin was here, but all of you, faculty and staff, show this deep care for our students. This fall, Puentes is attending the University of Oregon to begin his research fellowship, and he credits the faculty with turning him on in the classroom and in the labs to this research. And you may know or recognize Matthew Braganza. He was very active here at Central Washington University. He was a student ambassador, giving tours. He assisted in the food pantry. He was always around. And if you know Matthew, you know he's extremely intelligent, very motivated, very determined. But he said it was the faculty who helped him find his way. He knew when he came here he wanted to be a business major. But it wasn't until he took a financial accounting that a fire was lit for him. And as a result of his academic and co-curricular work and the inspiration of his faculty, Matthew has been accepted to and is now at Cornell University, pursuing a master's degree in accounting with a scholarship that covers most of his expenses. Matthew is a first-generation student from Yakima whose life has been changed as a result of what you do. Thank you so much for that dedication and commitment. So we know that's for you. We know why we're here. We're opening doors for students and allowing them to be successful in realizing their dreams. We're creating futures for students who may not have known that these futures were possible. We do this through very specific practices. As our mission statement declares, we foster high-impact practices, sustainability, and authentic community partnerships that are grounded in meaningful relationships. And we do this work, as our unifying value declares, through providing a supportive learning environment where faculty and staff inspire students to become engaged professionals, active citizens, and lifelong learners. Your inspirational work is evident in the work that we have done both with our current students and with our alumni. Two students from our Douglas Honors College, Emma Crow and David Torem, represented Central Washington University in Bangkok, Thailand, for the inaugural United Nations Green Summit. They were among the 157 delegates from 31 different countries, two of our students, who attended this conference last December. David also attended the Unite 2030 conference in September, a United Nations conference for young leaders focused on sustainable development goals. And as a result of this experience, Emma was able to secure a job as donor coordinator with Wenatchee-based nonprofit Sister Connection. Thank you for the work of the Honors College, and thank you to Dr. Chris Dennison. I know she's in the room someplace. Raise your hand, wave higher. And thank you to Dr. Anne Cubier, who has provided leadership for the Honors College over the last several years. Central Washington University alumnus David Puente Jr. was appointed as the new director of the Washington State Department of Veterans Affairs after serving as the department's deputy director for the previous 3 years. Puente earned his Bachelor of Science in Occupational Safety and Health from Central in 2000. He spent many years with the Washington Department of Labor and Industries before joining the Washington State Department of Veterans Affairs as deputy director in February of 2020. We have our why and our what. We must focus our attention now on how we will live into our vision. We will do so through a set of four values that flow out of the vision and mission, creating an alignment of the vision of where we want to go and how we will get there. Out of the vision and mission flows our strategic plan, our budget, our performance management system, enrollment management and recruitment, and our comprehensive campaign. I'm going to use these topics to frame the rest of the conversation. The foundation of our work will be our values-based strategic plan, which will be a living document giving direction to the decisions we make around resource allocation, evaluation of employees, recruitment of students, and fundraising. If you haven't, you can click on the QR code on your table or on the screen, and it'll take you to a page where you can click on a link and pull up the strategic plan. I'm going to refer to several specific goals as we go through this to talk about the way in which we are already living into this strategic plan. I would ask you to join me in thanking everyone in our community who participated in the development of the vision, mission, values, and strategic plan over the last year. We had such robust participation, and especially in thanking our steering committee who guided this work. But a word of caution before I get started. We've all heard this famous saying from Peter Drucker, culture eats strategy for breakfast. Culture is invisible to us. It is the water we swim in. It's how we do things. It's how we've always done things. It can create inertia. It can stifle creativity, innovation, and change. And now we have a vision, mission, values, and strategic plan that are asking us to do things differently, to think differently, and to act differently. We have included in our strategic plan initiatives that will help us shift our culture. But we must all engage in those initiatives if that culture will be shifted. We cannot let our past stifle the opportunities we have to create a future filled with promise. We must recognize that our work is countercultural, and so it will be hard. But it is too important to be slowed or ignored. There is too much at stake. We've developed a budget model that I think will allow us to live into our vision, mission, and values. It includes four basic principles, which we begin with covering our instructional and non-instructional expenses. And then we need to right-size our goods and services. There's a great deal of work to be done around these things. I think that I have talked in several forums with you all about the way in which we're funded by the state of Washington. Rather than being fully funded for the cost of living raises that we give to employees, they only fund a portion of it. And we're supposed to raise the rest of it through tuition, which actually doesn't cover the rest of it. So we actually have a shrinking pot of money every year to pay employees. If you have less money every year to pay employees, what does that mean? You have fewer employees. We also don't get inflationary increases for our goods and services budget. And those things cost more every year. This next year, we will be working as a team in the Council of Presidents and the presidents of the six universities to actually make sure that we help the legislature understand the way in which that historic deficit is holding us back and we will ask them to fill that historic deficit. So more to come on that. I would ask you to join me in thanking all of the budget committees that have been part of the process of developing this model, all the shared governance groups, and especially Joel Klucking, Vice President for Finance and Administration. Joel, thanks. All right, tons of information on this slide. These slides will be available for you to look at. We're not gonna pause. I'm not gonna go through every line. But these are the actual end of the year expenditures and revenues, and you all should know what those are on an annual basis. One of the things I would ask you to look at is the operating net at the very bottom. You'll notice that sometimes it's a negative, sometimes it's a positive. When it's a positive, we put that in a surplus, that at years when we have a negative, we can pay for that, that deficit. So this will be up if you want more detail on our budget. This year, like many years, we will have a deficit. Our enrollment is down. It's not where we'd like it to be. Deficit will be a little over $2 million. Fortunately, most of that deficit this year will be covered by particular programs that we've been funded for by the state through policy initiatives that we didn't spend last year, and that money carries forward, and we will spend that money this year. So this deficit is covered by those funds. We could use reserves if we needed to. Fortunately, this year we won't need to. But the same is true in our system funds. These are our auxiliary budgets. We'll have about a $1.3 million deficit at this point because of lower than expected enrollment. This budget must come in at zero, however, because we must have enough funds in our revenue and expenses to cover our bond payments, which is at the bottom, that $12 million. So we will find ways also to balance this budget. We're required to do that. As part of our efforts to invest in our future, we're developing new funding streams for Central Washington University. We submitted a proposal to create the Central Washington Regional Tech and Innovation Hub under the U.S. CHIPS and Science Act. We work closely with 24 regional, state, and national organizations to support the proposed six-county tech hub. Our proposal focuses specifically on, first, robotics, automation, and advanced manufacturing, and second, natural and anthropogenic disaster mitigation and response. We were hoping to maybe have heard something about our initial application, which would generate about $1 million from the federal government as a first step towards a much larger grant application that we would make. But I think that there's some funky things happening in Washington, D.C. right now, so we probably won't hear anytime soon. There's a lot of work that's been happening in our College of Business around many of these issues, as well as in the College of Education and Professional Studies. One of the things that happened yesterday that was fantastic was that we've been working closely with, as our strategic plan asks us to, business industries and nonprofits in the city and county. That's one of the initiatives of the strategic plan. And yesterday, the Kittitas County Economic Development Strategic Plan gathered, there was a group of folks gathered to kick off that strategic plan and start talking about the way in which we would live into that strategic plan. It included members of Upper and Lower County. Clay Ellum was there, Roslyn was there, Kittitas was there, Ellensburg was there, the Chamber of Commerce was there, all the downtown associations were there. And what we heard over and over again from all of these folks was that they desire, they hunger, they want a closer connection to Central Washington University. And they talked especially about two opportunities that are in front of us. The first one is seeking a cultural arts designation here in Ellensburg. And as part of that, we've been working very closely with art and music and theater. Dania Cochran, who is in the president's office, has been helping bridge that partnership to make certain that we are players in that effort. But second, we heard yesterday a strong desire for more relationship with the city and county on business development and support. They are hungry for this work, and they know that if we're going to thrive into the future as a city and a county, they will need to rely on the university and the resources we have. They especially are looking for support with entrepreneurship, business services, and business development. They would love to have our students engaged in projects and programs with them as they think about those businesses and the development. And one of the wonderful things in my experience about that kind of work is that it can be a revenue generator for the institution. So a huge thanks to our College of Business. I know our new dean, Faiza Koja, is here. Faiza, you might wave. but also to Rog Ogborn, Bill Provoznik, and Janie Zenchek, whose leadership and expertise has really helped shape the process of this grant, as well as to Andrew Morse, who convened all of these people in our wonderful Hogue Hall to develop this. So Andrew, also thank you for your leadership. We've also applied for two grants from the Gates Foundation. The first grant, the Limitless Grant, will create a partnership between Central Washington University and Yakima Valley Tech, the Skills Center down in Yakima. And the focus is on layering many of our professional programs on top of their high school programs. We have many bachelor's degrees that layer on top of many of their programs. As I was talking with Trevor Green, the superintendent down there, what he says is that the students who go to YV Tech really see that as a pathway to a job, and that's it. They don't think about higher education. What we will do through the Limitless Grant is really talk about the way in which there's a pathway through this to an apprenticeship and perhaps a job, but then we have the bachelor's programs to layer on top of that so that at some point you can advance your skills, knowledge, and abilities and go to the next level. We found out earlier this week that we received that grant. Thank you to Dr. Yoshiko Takahashi, who's the Dean of Undergraduate Studies, for her work on that grant. Thank you, Yoshiko. The Horizons grant is a much larger grant that we just submitted last week, $5.4 million over 3 years. We've partnered with four school districts, Toppenish, Wapato, Yakima, and Zilla, as well as Heritage University, to create a rich dual credit ecosystem in the high schools. It'll include expansion of college in the high school so that students will seamlessly walk through college while they're in high school. You all may know this. In the past, the students and their parents had to pay for the college and the high school credits, which means there was only a certain demographic of student who got college and the high school credit. Now the state is paying for that. So the other 27 kids in a class of 30 who couldn't afford to get Central College and the high school classes will now be able to become Wildcats and get credits for those classes. I know Kyle Kerrigan is in the class, in the room. Kyle leads our dual credit ecosystem. I think this could be a game changer for us. I want to thank especially the deans who have really been brainstorming, talking about the challenges around this, and there are lots of challenges. Our associate dean and director of the School of Education, Jenny Deshane, who I know is in the house. Jenny, thanks for your leadership. We also had lots of support from other folks, Kirk Kirstein, Vice President for Academic Affairs, Manuel Rodriguez, and Andres Moreno in admissions. They supported this and were looking at community partners. Kyle, who I mentioned, but then I also want to give a special shout out to Christy Gilchrist and Kelly Quirk, who really pulled the grant together out of all the stuff we sent them and were able to submit it. Thank you all for your support with this. I know one of the questions that faculty have is, why should I do college in the high school? Can we demonstrate that students actually come here as a result of taking our class? And what I would ask you to remember is that in the past, it was students who had to pay for those classes. That's not our demographic. Those are students who go on very often to Washington or Washington State. This is now our demographic, and we're working very closely with several of those schools that I mentioned who will be perfect future Wildcats. We just need to help them see themselves as college students here at Central, and this effort will do this. I'll tell you a quick story. Last week or the week before, when the doors of Barge were open because we didn't have any air conditioning, I was coming back from a meeting, and I noticed six young Hispanic men peering in the door. And I walked up and I said, are you all new freshmen here at Central? You want to take a tour of Barge? And they were looking in kind of awkwardly, and they said, no, we're not freshmen. We're actually taking Central College and the high school classes over at Highline, and we didn't know anything about Central, so we thought we'd come over and check it out. They spent the day checking out. I took them up in the cupola. They got pictures of Ellensburg. They went to my office, and they got a picture. What a game changer this could be for us to help those students who didn't necessarily have access to these classes now have access to these classes. All right, let's talk a little bit about the projects we're working on now and then also the funding requests that we've made to the state in this supplemental year. So we are completing our health education and Nicholson Pavilion project. I've been saying that for like 2 months. Delano, when will we have access to this building? We receive, let me move on to the next one. This is gonna keep Delano busy too, like he and his team don't have enough to worry about. We received $103 million. I want you all to stop and think about this. I want you to think about this in the context of what's happening nationally to higher education. If you look at what's happening in Wisconsin or New England or West Virginia, they're cutting a bunch of programs. What programs are they cutting? Humanities programs, foreign language. We got $103 million to build a humanities and social science building here at Central Washington University. It will be heated and cooled with geothermal. The geothermal well will have the opportunity to heat and cool three other buildings. Wow, that's a change. We will be able to take down Language and Literature in Farrell Hall in mid-October. In mid-October, you'll start to see fencing go up. Delano, you got everybody on a roll, buddy. You'll see fencing going up. They will start doing abatement within Language and Literature, and then they will take it down in about 2 months. For all of you who are in Language and Literature, Delano promised me he would save you a brick if you want one in your new office. I do want to acknowledge the disruption this causes. I appreciate the fact that faculty have had to be flushed out of Language and Literature and they're living in other spaces that you all have. One of the things that I have found in my career as we do these kinds of things and all of a sudden you have the history department living in the psychology building is that you all get to know each other across disciplines and you're like, oh my gosh, I didn't know you were working on that stuff. That's so cool. So it is a disruption. I apologize for that disruption. It's going to be a couple of years. But when we get to the other end of this, like if we ever get to the other end of the Nicholson Pavilion, we will be in a really good place. We also received $6 million for the academic portion of the multicultural complex. We will be working with the students on the funding for their portion of it, the student portion of it. That's next. That'll happen in the next year. But we are starting the process of the design of the building, working closely with our students. This is something the students have been asking for and pushing for. They still don't believe that it's really going to happen because it's like you've been telling us. We got to make this real. This has got to happen in the next year so that our students can see this come to life. We also receive funding to complete a pre-design for our arts complex. We will have two pre-designs completed at that point, psychology and art, and we'll have to decide which one to ask for design funding from the state next. For the supplemental budget, the mid-biennium budget, we've requested additional funding for our student basic needs package. Our food pantry coordinator and interns have been paid at a one-time dollars. We've asked the state to make that permanent. We've asked for another violence prevention coordinator, financial literacy coaches. All of those things are really, really important. And we've asked for funding for college and the high school. That funding, like the Gates Grant, would provide funds for the faculty to develop programming at the graduate level, so that we can have the high school teachers certified to teach the classes. I will tell you, one of the things I'm really proud of is the way in which we are training those teachers to be really good teachers in the high school to meet our learning outcomes and their learning outcomes. As you may know, Brady Smith has taken over the food pantry coordinator position from Jada Nelson last year. Brady is the former vice president for ASCWU. Is Brady in the house? Brady, are you here? No Brady. The food pantry, and let me give a shout out to Sydney, the dean of the library. The food pantry is going to be moving into a much larger space during the course of this quarter so that they will have a bigger space come winter quarter. So thank you, Sydney, and the librarians for their support. I also want to thank our wellness office, who I know they're all here together at one table. Yep, there they are. And I also want to thank the CWU SAFE group from last year, including especially Marissa Howitt and Cindy Coe, who co-chaired CWU SAFE. who have elevated the conversation around gender-based violence prevention here at Central Washington University. We're going to have a special forum on that, I think, next week. I hope you all will show up to find out how we can all participate in that. But please join me in thanking Marissa and the entire office. On the capital side, we've requested funding for a second geothermal well for the south part of campus that would heat and cool four buildings. Our science building is a building that uses a lot of energy, so we're looking at a package to have carbon reduction in that, and then also an emergency backup system. I won't tell you which buildings don't have an emergency backup system, but we need one for those. So that's a fantastic request as well. As we shift our work to live into our vision, our mission, and our values, we also have an opportunity and an obligation, I think, to think differently and show up differently as we work together. And to assist us with that shift, we may begin a conversation that would help us define what it would look like to be a whole person, human-centered learning organization. How do we create a culture here at Central that allows every individual to show up for the whole person who they are, able to share their various races, ethnicities, genders, sexualities, abilities, in an environment of safety and belonging? How do we take the fullness of our humanity and make it central to how we come together as a community? These aren't easy questions to answer. These are really big, packed words in several forums where we've been talking about them. We're like, what does that mean? How are we going to know what that means? How are we going to define that? We do have several focused initiatives, however, written into our strategic plan that we will launch immediately, and that will help us discern this pathway forward to this wonderful place. I do greatly appreciate the leadership of Stacy Slay-Layman and our human resources team as they begin this process and have pushed us at ELT to think differently. Stacy, I know you're here. Thank you for that work. One of the initiatives of the strategic plan is to focus on the evaluation of our faculty and to revise our promotion and criteria, tenure criteria. This surfaced when I did my DEI listening. It was something that was resounding that we needed to address a lack of equity in our tenure promotion criteria. And then I also heard it, we heard it as a strategic planning team over and over again as we did all of our forums as we were working on our strategic plan. So this came from the university community. We have asked a consultant, Dr. Chris DeWeld. Chris is here. Chris, would you wave? She will be joining us for the next month to help us imagine a better, more equitable approach to faculty evaluation. Dr. DeWeld is professor of women's and gender studies and professor of sociology at the College of Charleston. She specializes in the study of intersectional inequalities in higher education and in leading organizational change for academic and social justice. Dr. DeWeld will assist us as we think about new, more just and fair ways of evaluating faculty so that we can truly live into our vision statement. The opening town hall is Tuesday, October 3rd, right here, from 2 to 4. The focus is on faculty evaluation, but if you would like to learn more about equity in higher education, I would encourage you to attend. But this would be really important for all of our faculty, tenure, tenure track, and non-tenure. We will also be investigating our non-tenure evaluation processes. There will be follow-up convenings after this town hall and the weeks that follow that town hall that will be essential to the inquiry, imagination, innovation, and implementation stages of this. And I want to be really, really clear that what will happen at the end of this quarter is that we will get a report from Chris saying, here's what you all generated in terms of imagining an innovative way to do this work and to live into your vision. Here's possibilities, here's concerns that I see. That report will come to us. We will have to decide on next steps. We're not going to finish this in the fall quarter. I know I always run marathons at a sprinter's pace. We always go fast. We will go slow with this. Faculty must be involved in rethinking how we do this work, starting with the university criteria, the college criteria, and the department criteria. So this is a first step to launch us in a process of thinking differently and new. I will tell you that I got to know Chris about 20 years ago when she came to teach at Florida Gulf Coast University, and I ended up convincing her after, I think she made me meet with her 5 times, to be the director of general education. And after she agreed to it, I told her I wanted her to revise the general education program, which she did brilliantly. But part of the reason I asked Chris to join me on my leadership team, she became the associate dean eventually in undergraduate studies, was because she always challenged me. She always asked me to think differently. She always pointed out ways in which how I was thinking or showing up may have been done better or different. So, Chris, I appreciate the journey that I've been on. If I have learned and grown in this DEI work, I would point to Chris as one of my primary mentors for that. So thank you for your work, Chris. In order to truly engage those broader issues that we have, faculty evaluation is one. There's bigger issues that we need to engage here on our campus around DEI professional development. We've adopted an online training module, that's tier one, that will be expanded through extended sessions that will allow all of us to engage together and deepen our understanding of this important work. And in the coming weeks, you will hear more about this. Please join me in thanking Interim Vice President Lucinda Carnell and Dr. Sigrid Davison and the DEI Faculty Fellows for their work. All right, here's the headwinds, right? Enrollment and recruitment. So much of our work hinges on getting students here, and if there's something that keeps me up at night, I will tell you it's 2 things. The first thing is that we don't do a good enough job bringing all of those students into our community whose lives, whose families' lives, whose communities could be transformed. We have an obligation to our community to make certain that we are welcoming those students here. The second thing that keeps me up at night is that we lose a third of our freshmen by the end of their first year. A third of those students don't come back, and most of them don't go someplace else. We have a moral obligation to expand access to higher education and to make certain that those students are successful. Everything you do on a regular basis will advance that work. From faculty implementing culturally sustaining pedagogy and streamlining our curriculum, including our general education program. Chris, I didn't bring you for that, I promise. To staff creating culturally sustaining programs. I've had the opportunity to go to lots of programs at the beginning of this year. And we welcome our students in wonderful ways. To simple things like keeping our eyes up when we're walking around campus and greeting each other and saying hello. To making sure that the lawn is cut and the trash is emptied. All of those things matter. Every one of you has a role to play in this work. But we do face some headwinds, and I do want to acknowledge those headwinds. These are not insurmountable. We've got this, but you need to know what the headwinds are. So this is the trend line in the United States of high school graduates. It will peak here in a couple years and then start dropping. Fortunately, here in the state of Washington, it will go up or stay flat for several more years before it starts dropping. Many of you have probably seen this slide. I know Joel created this slide. We're gonna have to give it a name. It's what has happened in our enrollment is historic. It isn't like a little dip that we're gonna come out of now that the pandemic is gone. This will impact us for many years to come, and so we need to do the work now, even though it may take a year or two to bear fruit. We need to do that work now to make the changes we need to make to change this. Here's our total enrollment for the last several years. Here's some maybe good news, because this fits into our vision, mission, values, and strategic plan. We do have one population of students in the United States as a whole, and especially here in the state of Washington, that is growing rapidly. And that is our Latinx Hispanic population. We've now established an office, recruitment office, down in the Yakima Valley. Andres Moreno is running that office. That'll be a really important way in which we need to connect with our backyard and demonstrate that we care about our backyard. I will also say, I'm probably getting off my script, we have a fantastic interim director for admissions, Peg. Are you in the room? Is Peg here? Peg Blake. Excellent. Thank you, Peg. In order to have a consistent, clear, focused message, one of the things that I found interesting when I came here is all the different taglines we had about who we are, all the different messages about who we are. That doesn't help our brand. It doesn't help get our name out. It doesn't help people be inspired to join us. So if we want folks to be inspired to join us, what we've done is develop a very clear brand by a lot of listening sessions with the community. The essence of who we are is wonderful. What you all do for our students is you see futures for them that they didn't know they had. And we have a new marketing tagline. You may have seen it on our website, Create Your Future. We want to welcome students into a partnership where we work with them as they create a future for themselves. Much of what we've been working on over the last 2 years has been building this strong admissions team, and we really love the fact that Peg is here, but also a marketing, integrated marketing plan. I think Emily is probably in the room. Emily Aubert and her creative team have been doing fantastic work. Thank you both for what you've done to move us forward. One final thank you. Even though there are still some kinks, we have a new website up, which is a much better website in terms of recruiting students, even though there are kinks. So thank you to Marty Romero and his team, the web team. I don't know, is Marty in the room? Don't see Marty, but thank you to Marty as well and that team. All right, so here's some of the headwinds. As you can see from where we will end up this year, we had our goal was 1,800 new freshmen. I didn't look this morning. Joel, did you look this morning? 1,584, which is more than last year. I want to make sure we're moving in the right direction. So it will grow, hopefully. But we are launching this year our recruitment season with a full slate of admissions counselors, more counselors than we had last year. Those relationships in the high school are absolutely critical. We've done a fantastic job of building communities on the west side and the east side to make sure that we're recruiting those students. And so we must remember why we're doing this work, to offer transformational experiences for our students. Litzy Cruz never considered attending college until she moved to Puyallup and had two of her favorite teachers who were Central alum. And they inspired her to go on to college and become a teacher. And of course, because they were from Central, she came here. She just graduated from Central with her teaching degree and will start working this fall as a dual language third grade teacher back in Puyallup. Last year, I really love this. There's so many positive things we could say about what our student athletes do and what our athletics teams have done. We just had three members of our men's rugby team recruited to the National Rugby League. Volleyball, 11 years in a row in the NCAA tournament. Basketball, 2 years in a row. There's so many amazing things that we do on the court, but one of the things I'm most proud about what we do in athletics is what our students do in the classroom. So last year, we won the 2022-23 GNAC Academic All-Sports Award. This is an evaluation of the institution's performance in the classroom through cumulative GPA of all of your student athletes, including your red-shirted athletes. And Central Washington University has been at the top in terms of the academic all-honors for 3 years in a row. Fantastic work. That's a testament to the work that you all have done as faculty, as staff, in supporting them. What our coaches emphasize is that they're students first, and they need to make certain that they are doing really good work in the classroom, first and foremost. In order to provide more opportunities for our students, like Litzy, and to make certain that all of our students have equitable access to the kinds of support structures, programs, and projects, the high-impact practices that they need to succeed, we have launched a comprehensive campaign. Our campaign flows out of the vision, mission, values, connected to our brand and our strategic plan. Our campaign theme is futures, and it includes three areas of focus. First, creating opportunities for students so that they have the foundation for paying for school and meeting basic needs. Second, providing critical experiences for their academic and professional success, including high-impact practices. And third, deepening our impact as we expand programs and initiatives. And we have had some success in the work we have done. In the last couple of years, we have raised a little bit more than we had in the past. You'll see that several years ago, we were raising about $4 million a year. That bumped up to an average of about $8 million a year. This last year, it was just over $9 million. And it is distributed nicely across the university. Our endowment also has grown. We've been working hard with our donor base to help them understand that one of the things we want to do is create endowments, not just spendable funds. Spendable funds are great. It's a one-hit wonder. You get to see the impact immediately. You make a difference in students' lives. But an endowment will ensure the long-term future thriving of this institution. This is an area that we still have work to do. A few weeks ago, we gathered with our deans and our department chairs to broaden the priorities of the campaign, the kinds of things we will go out and ask funding for. During this retreat, which was led by Advancement Resources, we surfaced new and exciting ideas for this campaign. This work will continue as chairs and faculty generate new and impactful ideas for our campaign. We're also working with other areas of the university, including student engagement and success and athletics. Thank you to Paul Elstone, Sean Lowney, and Emily Adams, who are in the room. I see Emily over there. Paul is here as well, for their work leading the advancement team. I love this story. It's an $85,000scholarship grant, but I love this for the story that it is to getting to this place. So this is an example of the way in which we're expanding some of our fundraising. We recently attended an event over in Sammamish of one of our alumni, King County Sheriff Detective Jeannie Walford. Jeannie successfully investigated a fatal hit-and-run crash that led to the identification of a ghost, a phantom driver who caused the accident. And the family of the individual who died and the other survivors of the crash asked that the funding that was generated go to Jeannie, and Jeannie in turn gave it to our law and justice program so that we could continue doing this great work and sending people like Jeannie out into the state of Washington to serve justice, yes. The first two Walford scholarship recipients are here, incoming juniors Dakota Redbow and Rolf Ramier. So we've already launching those scholarships. All right, why are we here? At the end of episode 7 of season 2, Richie is once again seen polishing forks. But this time he's neatly stacking those forks in a row, not just throwing them. He understands that even polishing forks makes a difference. He finishes his task and he goes into the room next door and he sees the head chef early in the morning. And what is she doing? She's peeling mushrooms. And he's like, why in the world are you, the head chef, early in the morning here doing this menial task? And she says, because somebody today will appreciate the fact that someone took care with their meal. We change lives here at Central Washington University. The work you do day in and day out provides our students the opportunity to learn and grow and realize their potential. And very often, as I talk to our students and our alum, it's a potential they didn't even know that they had. And then they go out in the world and they make the world a better place to live, to work, and to learn. Thank you all so much for the work that you do day in and day out. And thank you so much for coming today. Have an awesome Friday and a great weekend.